Mr. Sergiu Zaharia is a cybersecurity officer at the Huawei Technologies. He received the Best Cybersecurity Ecosystem Award 2020 for Huawei from Digital Transformation Council of Romania. He is an IT security engineer with defense intelligence focusing on network security and cryptology, gathering multidisciplinary experience as Chief Information Security Officer with telco, banking, and retail players. As a member of the Business Continuity Management and Crisis Management Groups of Excellence in Deutsche Telekom, Sergiu benefited from a know-how transfer from top global cyber resilience experts. He was leading the Security Center of Excellence of BearingPoint in Romania, delivering security services, including penetration testing, security assessments, and security strategy advisory to European customers across several sections. So over to you, Sergiu, and welcome to the Rocheston Reinvent Cybersecurity Conference.
Hello, can you hear me well?
Yes, I can.
Okay, I'm Sergiu. I'm on the Nomad Beach in my holiday. I'm not sure you can see, but it's a lot of... this is the empty place on the beach.
It's beautiful.
It's a wonderful weather here. I found an isolated place. Hopefully nobody will start sinking here around. Today I will present select window or screen. Okay, just a second to select this one. I think no, it's not this one. No, I need to select something and I need to find the, okay, so I think yeah, that's it, perfect. I want to discuss today about the distributed SOC, the resilience through edge intelligence. The idea is to see how the security operations center will grow, will be part of our evolution in the future. But before that, just several words about myself. I'm a cybersecurity officer and privacy officer in Huawei Technologies Romania. And in my career, as you said, also I've been a cybersecurity officer or chief information security officer or just IT security engineer in different organizations like telecom, banking, retail, and some other sectors, or advisor in the same areas. And also I've started with the defense of Department of Defense in the InfoSec branch in the at the beginning of my career. Now I'm doing my PhD. Hopefully I will finalize it sometime, hopefully next year. And today I will speak about, as I said, about the SOC evolution, how this Security Operations Center started, actually, the challenges we've seen, and the trends. And let's start with this this very, very easy to understand slide, security, because we speak about security operation, and we all know that security started from mainly from two areas, from the military or from the IT, from the private organizations, because the IT was developing a lot of servers, applications, and they had to deal with the security. So security was has been started by IT guys that had to secure the infrastructure. They had some malware and they had to find a solution to clean those desktops or later laptops and so on. And in the past, in the companies that we've seen, we had mostly IT distributed teams that had to deal per region with the computers in that area, because somebody said, yes, I have a virus or my system doesn't work or I've lost some data and the computer is blocked and something like that. And they had to to go there in that county, in that city, to deal with that local problem. And then we've seen, because of the economic reasons, that the IT has been centralized mostly in the headquarters in each country or region. And then we've seen that this security operations center actually appeared as an entity, as a function, and they had some enabling technologies like security information event management, security information event management that did collect a lot of logs and so on, and did correlate those logs and so on. We had a centrally planned response to this type of incidents. But despite this centralization of the security operation, we've seen a lot of other teams, for example, the CERT, the NOC, Network Operations Center teams, that were not practically well integrated with this security operations center. Because I can give you an example, in a big telco company, the NOC team that is dealing mostly with the public network doesn't want to obey from the members of the SOC team that mostly came from the inside IT, the intranet IT. But in this context, everybody was formally gravitating around this security operation center, despite not being fully integrated with this center. And just a very short list of what are the main activities in this security management, security operation. We had mostly a security information and event management, as I said, collecting logs, making those logs looking similar, because the guys and girls in the security operation didn't know the details of all devices, how they log the events and so on. So CM did a very, very good uniformization of the events to be easily understood. And then we had a lot of privileged accounts, because you had also to know exactly who is dealing with what in that area, if it's an admin, if it's not an admin, and so on. And you had also to invest in this unified account management. And then you had also some intelligent analysis, which was baked up in the CM or in a different technology. Maybe you had some threat intel feeds from external organizations, and so on. And of course, on top, you had this risk management with vulnerability scans. You knew what type of systems you have in your network, for example, what versions when you have you had some event that you received in the CM technology, for example, you understood if it's really something which may be exploitable or not, if you are under risk or not. So that was the security. This is actually the security management in the real time monitoring and global response, if you have a global response. And then you had different layers, even for the SOC. Here it's a map, if you want, that we can see now, and we'll see for the upcoming 5G technologies. Below you see vendors that provide a lot of technologies for core network, antennas, and so on. And then at the middle you see the operators that provide the system. In this case, it's a 5G system, and they have a SOC because they need to manage the security of the carrier part. On top of them, we have the service providers like automotive, health care, and so on. Service providers on top of these technologies that they have their own security operation center, because they need to deal with the security of autonomous car, for example, and so on. And this security operation had a very, very good evolution because of the technology first. They are backed up by artificial intelligence-based solutions like end-user behavior analysis, and they start to be more and more automatic, to have a more automatic response. They are also collaborating with CERT because these are the teams that are dealing with the incidents at the national level or operator level and so on. And of course, you have also product security and response teams at the vendor level because they need to fix the vulnerabilities that might appear in the technologies they provide. This is something that is very interesting. Bruce Nair, even in 2018, he said that we need to get people out of the loop in order to deal with so many incidents, to do this automation a lot. On the other hand, incident response, as he said, is a matter of uncertainty and cannot be fully automatic. So you cannot plan for something which is uncertain. And of course, this is really important for the evolution of SOC and the CERT in the future. However, if we look just to how IoT attack map looks, this is from a paper. You see here a lot of attacks, and here you see only the big attacks with here we see number of targets like 5,000 targets. I don't want to insist on this map, but this is how SOC can see at the high level. But the SOC doesn't need only to see this very interesting picture at high level. This is just for the auditors that come to the SOC center, and it's nice to present them an interesting map. But in reality, you need to deal with all these attacks in details. And it's quite critical because you see the spread of the attacks is quite impressive if we speak about IoT devices. And why I say this? Because we should understand that yes, we should build machine learning automation in the SOC. That's really important. This is why actually we have already a lot of machine learning automation in the SOC. But what is really interesting is that if we introduce this automation using machine learning algorithms, artificial intelligence solutions, we need also to convince the security operations center analysts to trust these solutions, because there is a so-called semantic gap that is presented in this paper that is extracted below here. And this paper says that if you do not have explainable artificial intelligence that can justify the decision it takes for a specific event, the SOC analysts will not trust this machine learning algorithm anymore. So you will have a lot of automation based on artificial intelligence in the SOC, but at the same time, the SOC analyst will not trust this machine learning algorithm, and they will do they will are the same way like they did it in the past. They will analyze each event separately, manually, and so on. So there are also some solutions, of course, to have the analyst included in the process of developing these machine learning models to make their first more friendly with the machine learning algorithms, and to also improve this machine learning algorithm a lot, to do these usability tests also during the security development lifecycle. And this is one way to implement this AI-based automation in the SOC with wide acceptance. Gartner said that we'll have by 2024 something like 80% of the tools in the SOC based on machine learning algorithms. So this is an important step to also have the SOC analyst very, very willing to not only to use the machine learning algorithms because they want to use it, but to trust this machine learning algorithm. So this is one point. The second point that I want to present is what means edge when we speak about security operations center, because we know that edge is some form of a cloud, and it's closer to the systems, is not so far. This is why we named some part of the age we name it fog, despite the difference between edge and fog that I don't want to discuss here because it takes too much time to explain the difference. But edge in this context means, okay, the device is far away from the central point of management. And how much at the edge could the device be? And I can give you an idea about the edge from a very, very interesting paper named the Systematic Review of Bio-Cyber Interface Technologies and Security Issues. Because you see here these bio-nano things, they name it, meaning things that are practically implanted in our body that have some things to do, of course, from a medical perspective. They might be electronic tattoos that can do this transdermal drug delivery. You can connect to this electronic tattoo using some Bluetooth interface, Bluetooth communication that is using a bio-cyber interface. And you can control this bio-cyber interface via your smartphone, for example. So, using your smartphone, you can implant some medical solutions in your body to solve some health problems. So this is one example. Another example is this optical to chemical biological interface. For example, there are solutions based on processed E. coli bacteria, which these bacteria can modify the body pH values based on some light stimulus, and this helps humans through these chemical reactions to have a good reaction against some medical problems. And we have this bio-cyber terrorism also. You can imagine if you have something like a fake lead, I put it here, you can send the fake messages to this E. coli bacteria. Or if you can hijack the Bluetooth 5.0 from less than 400 meters, you can inject more or less drugs in your body. So this bio-cyber terrorism is really important now. And the issue with the SOC is that you don't have too much reaction time from the moment you collect those events from these bio-cyber interfaces. Actually, it's a body API, I name it. You don't have so much time. Milliseconds are not enough before the organism might be affected. So at the edge, you cannot wait too much to do collection, correlation of the events and the reaction. So you need some other thing. And this need for speed is also valid for 5G technology. They come up with this ultra reliable low latency communication, allowing us to have latency 50 times better than in 4G networks. And also it allows us to have a lot of edge devices through this massive machine type communication, meaning it's a parenthesis lag here, sorry. When you have, for example, 1 million devices per square meter. So this is the edge right now. Low latency, they need to communicate fast, and there are a lot of devices on the kilometer square. And what is important is that based on some other research papers, one is explained even here, you see that, for example, more than 13% of the events that are coming from IoT devices to a CM, to a SOC, for example, SOC technology, are coming in the incorrect order. So once you receive the events in CM, you don't have the right order to understand if, for example, the car stopped or the car started, which is really important. If a car is in front of a stop sign, the car has to stop, but you don't know yet if the car stopped or not, because the event might come in incorrect order and it might accelerate, for example. And more than that, something like almost 30% of the commands that are coming from the SOC, if you have a tool that is securing, is blocking some port and so on, they come also in the incorrect order, which is also important. If you want to stop a train on the rail, you have an issue if you have 30% of the actuation commands in the incorrect order. You don't know yet if the train received the commands to stop or not. So at the edge, the SOC technology doesn't work the same way like they work in the normal network-based technologies like today. And this is why we need some self-resilience through edge intelligence, meaning we need to have a solution right at the edge to solve everything in that place at that moment, not to take everything to traverse a lot of hundreds of kilometers to go to the central SOC to solve an issue. And this is also something that is stipulated in a paper that I found very interesting this year, related to smart grids in this case. They said that you need to have first a high level of observability and to have also some resiliency and multiple means of reporting validation. But what is important is if you have a node, for example, a link, which is compromised, the system shall easily identify the attack and take recovery step with confidence. So if you imagine a very large smart grid or smart city, you can imagine that you might have millions of nodes in a country. So if 1,000 of them are going down, are compromised, they should be somehow avoided, and the system should be resilient enough, like the principle of internet in the past, when the internet started, and that internet was based on the resilience of the internet nodes. And here is an example of from a paper related to smart cities. I said that we need this type of resilience. First of all, to have at edge level some automation to solve the issue at that place at that moment. In a smart city, you have some levels, for example, edge, network, application, and hardware level. And if we speak at the edge and cloud level, here you might find the data related to public traffic, to vehicle recording, signal control, and even health data or GPS. If we speak about devices, of course, you might have smart meters, smart cars, and even smart peacemakers, and so on. And the attacks might be medical, ransomware, energy hacking, and so on. So, but what is important is that even this research found out that you need something like a cyber patrol bot, similar to a police patrol, that has to walk around and to find the issues in the smart city in the same way like a police patrol find, malicious people in some neighborhoods and so on. So they need to find the behavior of some IoT devices or some smart cars, smart peacemakers. If they behave strangely, not following the policies of this smart city, they need to secure and to take measures at that moment in that time. So that's a really, really interesting finding of this paper, this edge cyber patrol bot that can walk to the smart city and can find, or it might be a smart grid, why not? And they find the malicious behaviors of some IoT devices, and they can stop it, secure them, and so on, which is really, really interesting from this point of view. Now, if we look to these large and critical infrastructures, we can imagine that if we have attacks like advanced persistent threat attacks, these APTs have in general low profile, so they are planted a day and it takes 6 months or more, maybe years, until they execute some payload. They just stay there. They do lateral movement in the smart grid, and if you have a smart grid, for example, smart infrastructure, you have in general very you have many nodes. That means you have some sparse data. If you want to teach a machine learning algorithm how to detect an APT, and this paper found some solutions using deep reinforcement learning that can learn, despite this huge network, how to identify the behaviors of unknown threats and to create automated security agents that can mitigate these advanced persistent threats. So we have a cyber patrol bot that can identify, using this deep reinforcement learning for security orchestration, that can identify this malicious behavior. So at the edge level, you are quite close to find a way to make everything more resilient and autonomous. And this is not enough, because you also need some sort of, if you want, collaboration at this level between between organizations. Here is an example of a paper that says a really important thing. Of course, it's better to have a friend than an adversary in any fight, that's for sure. I think everybody agrees with this. But also, what they demonstrated through experiments was that if you have some neighbors, and when I mean neighbors, meaning I mean, for example, some let's say some companies that are hosted in the same building, or they are very close geographically, and they have some common point of presence in the network level and so on, but not necessarily. So what has been demonstrated is that if you don't have enough power, this is the target T, if you don't have enough power to protect from a distributed denial of service cyber attack, because this attack might be, for example, 1 terabyte, a terabit per second, then if you collaborate with some neighbors around, the cost of the distributed denial of server attack grows by 1,000 times. So imagine if you pay, for example, 10,000 euros to attack an organization through DDoS, you now multiply this cost by 1,000 times. So economically, it's not feasible anymore, so you stop the attack because you don't want to pay and not to solve the problem. And how this joint defense work, these neighbors put their resources together. For example, there is an upstream operator that can reroute the traffic, not to the target, but to many targets that voluntarily become targets of this attack. And in this way, the infrastructure, the defensive infrastructure, the security infrastructure is scaled at the point that can, as I said, increase the cost of attacks by 1,000 times. And here, for example, there are many examples in the paper, but I can give you one. You definitely should read it. With two neighbors, two defenders, so if you have two neighbors, and you have a denial of service against the web server, the initial delay of the request, the legitimate request to the web server, is 0.86 seconds, which is quite impactful. Okay, so we don't have this now. We don't want now to wait almost 1 second to download the page, of course. But only with two neighbors, it goes down to 0.14 seconds, which is quite acceptable when you are under attack. So now we can imagine that we have this edge intelligence, edge automation, and also edge partners to create something that can help us to deal not only with some specific attacks, but also with important attacks like distributed denial of service, which are in general very, very difficult to deal with. Of course, if you are an organization, very strong organization with a lot of infrastructure, it's fine. You can have DDoS services, anti-DDoS services, and so on. But now we speak about the edge technologies, edge users, with maybe 100 devices each of them. So you need to collaborate with the others and to be protected. And this is the evolution of the SOC. As I said, we started from the traditional SOC where everything was just becoming centralized, and because of this latency, meaning the speed you need actually in the networks and the latency that impacts the SOC operation, you move again to a distributed SOC that you have to distribute it to the edge. And if you distribute the SOC to the edge, you need to add some intelligence there because you cannot control it in a timely manner. So it becomes more autonomous and you have autonomous edge security operations centers. And if it's not capable enough to deal with important cyber attacks, this SOC need to cooperate with the neighborhood partners. So you need also a joint defense autonomous SOC that can work in a collaborative way until you can reach something like SOC swarms in the similar way that you see the drone swarms acting together. And the potential services that you'll see in the future, services that now SOC providers are delivering, might be SOC swarms orchestration services, meaning orchestrating some small, very small SOCs at the edge level. So because the time is flying away, some takeaways from this presentation are presented this slide. For example, the SOC. The SOC has to be distributed to the edge because of these latency issues and because of the fact that the edge is moving, including to the body APIs and so on. So you don't allow to lose time in dealing with incidents when you speak about human's body. And then if you move to the edge, you need to leave the security operations center some autonomy to decide very, very fast. So of course, this autonomy comes up with some self-intelligence, which of course is based mostly on machine learning algorithms, artificial intelligence, and so on. It doesn't mean that humans will not be involved, but you need some speed and some decision at this edge level. And joint defense also makes the edge even stronger. So when you have small organizations dealing with important attacks, if they are intelligent and they collaborate and they create this joint defense mechanism, they become stronger and they can also aggregate in a big SOC swarms, maybe in the next 10 years, which might be orchestrated by some big companies that some of them are now delivering SOC services. So this is some of the future evolution ideas of security operations centers that I found very, very, very interesting and useful to share with you based on the academic research papers that I've read in the last year. So thank you so much for listening to me. If you want to read more about these ideas, you can follow me also on LinkedIn or Facebook and so on. Thank you so much for allowing me again to present this from this nice beach. I hope the wind was not so strong and that you could hear me very well.
Hello, Sergiu, thank you so much for that presentation. We had a wonderful time, especially from the beautiful view that you had in the background. So we do have a couple of questions for you from the participants. Can you hear me, Sergiu?
Yes, very well. Very well.
All right. All right. All right. So the first question, if there is a failure, how will the edge provider ensure the application recovers?
The application recovers. So if we speak about edge, we speak mostly about we have two levels at the edge. We have the service providers, for example, providers of autonomous vehicle systems, and we have the car themselves or small devices. If it's a car, yes, it's a little bit more complex, but there are some already some papers that says that if you have some IoT devices, now, even with this small processing power, small storage they have, and small apps you have on those devices, you can put on that IoT device, which might be a robot, of course, an industrial robot, you can put on that device some agents that can identify how secure a software or if a software is compromised on the neighboring IoT device. So if you have something like an Industry 4.0 plant and you have 100 robots, each small robot might have an agent like an intrusion detection system agent or similar, because I've seen a presentation with static application security testing before, something like a small SAST agent that can look to the other IoT device and see if it's compromised or not. And then you can precise code like drivers and some well-defined functions, so not a very artistic source code, I would say, you can have automatic fixes using machine learning algorithm. This research started, I don't know, 86 by MIT to rewrite automatically some code. So this can be possible in the future to rewrite the applications. Now there are some papers that can translate, for example, vulnerable code in non-vulnerable code using neural machine translation solutions that are used now by translators from English to, I don't know, Indian or the opposite. So yes, you can fix those apps that are affected using even these IoT devices at the edge level. If it's an application that is controlling, for example, at the country level, some autonomous car services, this has to be fixed, of course, at the service provider level. You cannot fix it to the edge. It's impossible because it's highly complex, tens of millions of lines of code. You need to fix them like we fix it today.
Right. Going to the next question. There are several challenges in managing network and computing resources involving enterprise data centers and the cloud. How can the edge resources be efficiently managed?
If you just make a parallel now between, for example, data loss prevention solutions. Data loss prevention solutions have a central part that is on the border, on the gateway. Okay, so it stays on the server and it has some list of rules, and these rules usually stays in a specific server and it looks to the proxy, internet proxy, and so on. But they also have some agents on the laptops, for example, or on the smartphones. And these agents are not so powerful. They are not so powerful, so they are not so complex to deal with every rule that you can find on the server. Okay, so we cannot expect to have 100% fully resilience on those IoT devices, but if we apply the Pareto principle, we can prioritize the threats Using only 20% of the power that we can find on those small devices, we can deal with more than 80% of the most important threats. So that gives 80% resiliency at the edge and at the device level. And the edge is close to the device. And this is why we actually built the edge. Because if we have a road infrastructure with autonomous vehicles, we'll see it soon. We'll see a lot of small, very small data centers across the street. And we will have this latency to communicate between the cars and street sides, antennas, infrastructure, and so on, and to the edge after that. To the edge data center, the small data center. So gradually we can use, as I said, 20% of the capacity to deal with 80% of the threats at car level, and then use these communications very fast to the data centers at the edge to add the extra layer of protection, meaning extra rules, extra intelligence. Because yes, that's definitely a very good question. You cannot put everything on the edge device now because we don't have the perfect power for this. But we will see the start of this. I think I've lost somebody here. Hear me? You're still Navid or Sumi. Okay. You came back.
Sorry, we had a small interruption there. I'm so sorry.
No problem.
Yes. I have the next question.
Please, but I cannot hear you now.
You hear me now, Sergiu?
Now is perfect. Yes.
Yeah. All right. The next question is. There is a popular opinion that edge computing replaces public clouds. Is that true?
The edge computing is how?
There is a popular opinion that edge computing could replace public clouds.
I don't think this will replace public. Actually, if we look to the future, why we have edge computing? We have edge computing because we need to get closer to the devices in, for example, 5G infrastructure, because we need speed. We need a quick reaction. So we cannot wait for the signal to go to cloud and so on. We don't even clouds. We have clouds here. So you cannot wait for this. So this is why we have the edge. However, this question or observation is really very good because we have such an important increase in processing power today that in the future we might not need the cloud anymore because we'll have all the processing power needed in the edge. But as we as a society build things that are challenging the processing power all the time, and you can see in the mobile level, the smartphone and device and so on. We also have a lot of complexity in the new application that will need more processing power, so we'll still need cloud. So it's a philosophical debate, I think. But with the current processing power, we still need cloud, but in the future we might not need cloud, but only if we do not make more complex things. So yeah, it's a philosophical question here, but yes, for the next infrastructures we might not need cloud, but cloud is also a concept of where you keep the intelligence. So cloud might be from a business perspective, the point managed the entity managed by an external provider of solutions and so on, and the edge just a level to send these services to the other. So from a processing power perspective, yes, we might not need cloud, but it distribute everything on the edge, you know? It's more difficult from a point of view.
Right. The next question, SOC analyst outsourcing, is it a good idea in terms of privacy regulations and compliance?
It depends now, because SOC, it depends on the level of SOC first.
Right.
If you speak about privacy, well, today we have events in SOCs, events that mean IPs which might be public or private, which might be associated with a customer or not. It might be just an internal server and so on. And yes, today we still have to deal with this topic of privacy in our SOCs. If you distribute this this SOC or not, you still have you should consider this like splitting an organization in 10 organizations. All those 10 organizations have to follow the same rules, like GDPR in Europe or some other privacy rules in some other countries or regions. But SOC had always to deal more with technical events. And this is important. If SOC also includes some data loss prevention events, that becomes a little bit more sensitive. Or bad area network events and so on becomes sensitive, and you might need to do an extra privacy impact assessment on these processes. And yes, ensuring the same things like data minimization. Okay, I speak now more in GDPR. I know it's an European topic, but it's based on best practices. You need to collect as less as you can personal data. You need to encrypt that data, and you need to now you can encrypt the logs. You can store the logs to retain them only a period of time and so on. So it's common sense. It's best practices anyway. Only the fines are higher, but you need also to apply the best practices in securing not only the privacy, the personal data, but also the logs, the events themselves. If you look to even to ISO 27001, I think that there is also a requirement to secure the logs. Even in this old standard of information security management system. So, yeah, it's just best practices. But, yes, if we speak about decentralization of SOCs, as I said, you split one organization in 10 organizations, and you need to apply the same law to every organization.
Yes. All right. So the next question, bioterrorism is really scary. Should we scan our internals before entering offices? Is this going to be the new normal?
No, I don't think that you need to scan people when they enter a building or something like that. Bioterrorism is practically something that affects us as individuals. It might affect us. What is important is that those devices, anyway, those devices need to be managed from a security perspective. If you cannot collect events from those devices and send it to a central SOC, but you can have the right to protect yourself. So you as an individual, if you want to be protected, you can, for example, ask for some services to some provider to be sure that you have the right patches if there is the case, because in the same paper, if I remember well, it says that people are scared about patching those devices because they might be impacted. But it's something like a vaccination. It should not be mandatory, but you should have the right to do it if you want. So somebody is vaccinated because he or she wants, somebody is not. But you still need to have the right to be protected. And I did say about SOC swarms and SOC orchestrations. So we should have in our logical neighborhood some SOCs that can offer the services to protect our devices, for example, nanobio things, and some other devices, now IoT smart home and so on. So we need to, and the people in general trusting more the neighborhood, meaning the people they know. If somebody from a central organization, like a big hospital or something like that, or CERT, something like that, they said, okay, from now on we need to scan your body and to scan everywhere you are entering to see if you are patched or not, of course this is unacceptable. But if I have a service in my district somewhere or in my company somewhere, which from my logical perspective is my trusted area, it's even better. It's even right. better because it's like you have this authentication brokers.
Right.
Okay, I trust some specific broker and I authenticate myself using that broker. So for me, it's okay if I trust that broker. So it's the same. I need to have the right, I should have the right to secure the devices like bio, nano things, devices. But this is really what is linked to what I said. It should be close to me, close to my age. And then, yes, there should be some orchestration, some intelligence that comes from some cloud that I need to trust this this very, very close, this very close SOC service provider, for example. I cannot hear you very well now.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear
yes.
me now?
Yes,
yes. All right. So we will have the last question. How many people are required for the SOC team for a small and medium sized corporate, IT corporate?
Very good question, because we know that medium sized teams don't have this capability generally, or they mixed it with some IT teams and so on. SOC is people, processes, and technology. So for a company, for example, with, 1,000 people, if you have standard SOC technology like CM, something like that, you might have three people dealing with incidents if it's really critical for you. But it's still difficult, even from companies with 1,000 people, to have those three people. So if you have, for example, small SOCs with 2-3 people in this type of organizations, you can also, in your neighborhood, help the others, the other organizations which are smaller, like 100 people or something like that, to benefit from your operation. To have this agreement, this orchestration in joint defense, SOCs and so on. Because even if you have or not the people for the SOC, you still have a firewall, you still have some other solutions, technical solutions that can help your infrastructure. You don't have money to pay also an expert. So if you do this joint defense, you can have, for example, 50 organizations with very, very small SOCs and some joint defense mechanism, and you can aggregate like 5 or 8 people already for, 3,000 people in total of those organizations. So, and you are on the same in the same neighborhood. I like this term. It's not the neighborhood in a negative way. In that neighborhood, you have several thousand people with 5 SOC team members, and it's quite impressive if you can aggregate those things. And from a research perspective, if you look for papers in this area, you'll see that there are experiments already that are very, very promising, and we can do this. Why not? We are not having all of us very big companies and with, I don't know, 100,000 people or 10,000 people. But we might benefit from other SOC providers, because there are already SOC providers, but why not? We can put our capabilities. We do not afford the services of SOC providers, why not? And we can build this joint defense community to protect ourselves. And in the future, you'll see more communities like this developing in SOC swarms, I like this term, orchestrated maybe by some other entity that can help us be more efficient. Why not?
Right. So, Sergiu, that brings us to the end of the question session. So, thank you so much for in the presentation. It was absolutely interesting, and I think our participants loved the view and your presentation as well. And we hope to have you next time from a different location and a different view. So thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. All right. Thank you for accepting. Thank you.
All right. Yeah. Bye-bye.